just love looking at the lights of 14th Street for the past 4 hours now. But perhaps you better call a hack, or we won't get to the Harmonia Gardens on time. Look, there's one! Yahoo!
Oh, no, Mrs. Malloy, there's no need for a hack. It's not the money or anything, it's just that really elegant people don't use hacks.
Hacks is out.
They all go less streetcar.
J.P. Vanderbilt, Diamond Jim Morgan.
Then by all means a streetcar. Imagine, just think, I've been elegant all my life and never even knew it.
Well, if you want to be really elegant.
We do!
You walk. Yes, New York, it's really a spot to be at. Cornelius.
All the guests of Mr. Hackle are feeling great and look spectacular. What a man! There is the man acting like a born aristocrat. We've got elegance. If you ain't got elegance, you can never.
Thank you. Oh, it is mine order as head vet of the Harmonia Gardens and your supreme commander that tonight of all nights our usual lightning service be twice as lightning as ever. Horus!
With oyster stuffing!
you to worry about our digestion, Cornelius, but I'm sure the pheasants are fresh. We'll take 4 plates and a nice red wine.
No wine.
No wine?
Champagne!
Champagne!
That's once in a lifetime, Barnaby. Champagne and Neapolitan ice cream and hothouse peaches. Barnaby, take a nickel to the band leader. Tell him to play To a Wild Rose. I want music while we dine.
What are you doing in that getup? And you're half an hour late. I demand an explanation of...
Ernestina.
Exactly.
Ernestina, whom I trusted.
She wanted to do the hoochie-coochie.
Well, she always was artistic. Horace, I'm going to have our table moved down front. There's a dancer in the polka competition I particularly want you to see.
What you wanted? A chicken! Now, Miss Levi, about that hoochie-coochie girl.
Did you say a chicken? Oh, I don't think I could face a chicken. Not a chicken, not today, after what's happened.
Good, then cancel the chicken.
Bring a turkey.
What are you doing now?
Oh, nothing. Looking the place over, getting acquainted with my surroundings.
That's the issue with you, Dolly. Always wanting to know everything. Always putting your nose in other people's affairs. Or anyone that married you would get as nervous as a cat.
What? What's that you said?
I said anyone that married you would get as nervous
as... Horace Vandergelder, get that idea out of your head this minute. Why, the idea of you even suggesting such a thing. Understand once and for all that I have no intention of marrying you.
I didn't mean that.
I certainly do hope not. Horace Vandergelder, you go your way. I will go mine. I'm not some Irene Malloy whose head can be turned by a few chocolate-covered peanuts. Unshelled. Why, the idea of you even suggesting such a thing.
Miss Levi, you misunderstood me.
I certainly do hope so. If I had any intention of marrying again, it would be to a far more pleasure-loving man than you. However, we won't discuss it anymore. Here's the waiter with our food. I'll serve Mr. Vandergelder. Here's some white meat for you. Ooh, and some dumplings. Light of an air they are. Oh, and I think I'll give you... very tender, very good for you. No, Horace, as I said before, you go your way, and I will go mine. Oh, start right in on the wine. I think you'll feel better at once. However, since you brought the matter up, there's one more thing I ought to say. Thank you, Rudolph, dear. Thank you, John.
I didn't bring the matter up at all.
Well, it's true, Horace. I'm a woman who likes to manage things, who likes to be in control of everything. But the one thing I wouldn't like to manage is something as out of control as your household. You'll have to do that yourself, God helping you.
It's not out of control.
Very well, let's not say another word about it. Ooh, have some beets, Horace, they're good.
I don't like beets.
That's nice. No, Horace, a complaining, quarrelsome, friendless soul like you is no sort of companion for me. You salt your beets, and I will salt mine.
Would you stop saying that?
I won't say another word.
Good.
Except this. At your age, Horace, you should enjoy hearing the honest truth.
My age? My age? You're always talking about my age!
Well, dear, I don't know what your age is, but I do know that Yonkers with a bad food and bad temper, you'll double it in 6 months. Have some more beets, Horace. They're so lovely.
I don't like beets! I hate beets!
That's nice. No, the pity of it is, you could be a perfectly witty, charming, amiable man if you wanted to.
I don't want to be charming!
Oh, but you are. Look at you now. You can't hide it. Now sit down, Horace, and let's talk of something else. However, there's one more thing I am going to say.
I don't want to hear it. I'm not going to ask you to marry me.
I suppose that means you want me to ask you. Well, I'm sorry, Horace. I'm turning you down.
How can you turn me down when I haven't asked you anything?
It's no use arguing. I've made up your mind. Now come here, let me cut your wings.
I have a headache. I'm going back to my hotel.
Oh, you can't go now. The competition's about to begin.
No. Here. Here's $20.
No, Horace. Put that away. Rudolph!
Wait a minute. There's nothing in here but...
Dear, would you please move our table?
3 pennies and a button!
Right over
there. This isn't my purse! I've lost my purse!
Mr. Vandergeller needs to better see the dancer's graceful movements. I think he has. And forgot his hat.
Horace. That purse you found.
What about it, Cornelius?
I think it's Vandergelder's.
Oh, you're right! We better get out of here!
Impossible, dear. I can't imagine you without your purse.
I have never been here. They don't know me. Stop paying the attorney! I can't pay for it!
Horace, it's the latest thing, the polka. There's one dancer I particularly want you to see.
Wait a minute! That man! That dancer!
Oh, isn't he wonderful? With talent like that, he's sure to win the solid gold cup.
Thank you. Say, is there anyone here to speak on your behalf? Miss Dolly Levi, counselor at law.
Your Honor, the defense rests.
No, there is no need to call witnesses, ladies and gentlemen. When I see upon that bench a brow that gleams with honor, a pair of snow-white whiskers that bristle with fair play, and a nose, I ask you to look at that nose, ladies and gentlemen. A nose that shines in the night like a flaming beacon of justice, a living symbol of the motto of this great land, E Propuscus Unum. Your Honor, I ask for freedom for my clients and a verdict of guilty for the one true culprit. Orvis Vandergelder of Yonkers, New York.
Dolly!
The one man responsible for willful destruction of private property.
A curtain torn, a vetter bruised, and a solid gold cup bent.
Cruelty to a poor, unfortunate minor. Would you mind repeating that, dear?
Mrs. Levi, if it pleases the court, I'd like to say something.
I was just about to call on you, Mr. Hackle. Go right ahead.
Mr. Levi, against me, I'll have you discharged.
You've already done that, sir.
I'll do it again.
You've done it again, too, sir. And even if you didn't, I'd still say what I'm about to say. I don't know much about inciting a riot or disturbing the peace. But what I do know is that what happened to me today, the most important thing that can happen to a man in his life. What I'm talking about is love.
You're telling me, after 33 years, you get one evening off and you fall in love?
Oh no, Mr. Vandergelder. I didn't fall in love with Miss Irene Malloy in one evening. No, not even an hour. That's too long. What's less than a minute?
Second.
What's less than that?
A moment.
That's it. I'll go slow so you can write it all down. Once had a wonderful day.
I missed a few words back
dismissed. All dismissed. All except Horace Vandergelder of Yonkers, New York. You're free, my children. Go, go.
Shuffle off to glory, should have said so long.
and I would marry you if you're the last woman on Earth! Not if you asked me a million times! Not if you're the last woman on Earth! I didn't need you before, I don't need you now! Dolly Gallagher, you go your way, and I'll go mine! Dolly! Dolly! Dolly!
You stamp, Mr. Vandergelder?
What? Oh, come call him back at me, Mr. Hackle!
No, Mr. Vandergelder. I've come to collect my $146.35. You see, I've decided to go into business. Since the only business I know is paying fees, well, I opened up a store.
Cornelius has found the perfect location, Mr. Vandergelder. Right across the street from you.
So you think you can compete with Vandergelders, do you? Well, you just try! Oh, another one could crawl back. What do you want?
Mr. Vandergelder, I've come to collect my back salary for the past 4 months. $6.12.
You can't do this! I'll go to the courts! I'll get lawyers!
Why, Horace Vandergelder, as I live and breathe, if you are handsome in that outfit. So few men nowadays have courage to wear fawn, yellow, and top.
Dolly Gallagher!
I know exactly what you're going to say, Horace. You're not satisfied with Ernestina. Well, that's all right, because I found you the ideal wife. But don't let me interrupt you. You were doing something. What were you doing?
Getting Cornelius' money. $146.
And 35 cents.
And $6.12 of mine.
And the $52.48 my mom left me.
38.
48.
All right, if it's money you want, the safe's upstairs!
Money, 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 money. Mr. Vandergelder's money. It's like the sun we walk under. It can kill or cure. Now, Vandergelder's never tired of saying that everyone in this world is fools, and in a way, he's right, isn't he? Himself, Cornelius, Irene, myself, we're all fools in danger of contaminating the world in our folly. The sure way to prevent us from doing harm is to provide us with the 4 or 5 human pleasures that are all right in this world, and that costs a little money. Now, the difference between a little money and no money at all is enormous, and that can shatter the world. And the difference between a little money and an enormous amount of money is very slight, but that can shatter the world too. It's all in how we use it. My late husband, F.M. Levi, used to say, money, pardon the expression, is like manure. It's not worth a thing unless it's spread around, encouraging young things to grow. Anyhow, that's the opinion of the second Mrs. Vandergelder. Which reminds me, Ephraim, I'm ready for that sign.
Well, don't just stand there, you that goes upstairs!
As I was saying, Horace, I found you the ideal wife.
Dolly Gallagher, I don't want you to find me an ideal wife. If I don't want to find a wife, I'll find it myself, and it's you! Damn it!
My Horace?
I know I've been a fool, don't miss the lawyer and that other woman, but Dolly, forgive me and marry me.
Horace, stop right there.
What?
Horace, you know as well as I do that you're the first citizen of Yonkers, and your wife would have to be a somebody. So answer me, am I a somebody?
You are a wonderful woman.
Oh no, Horace, you're partial. No, it wouldn't be enough for you to load your wife with money and jewels and insist she be a benefactress to half the town. By the way, it's bad business having Cornelius open a store across the street from you. Better take him back and let him be a partner.
Partner?
Oh, and Barnaby can have Cornelius's own job.
No, hold on a second, Dolly.
That way we can all be together to dance at Ermengarde's wedding.
That's it, you've gone too far. I'll dance at no weddings. Besides, I don't even know how to dance. It could take me weeks, months. Years to learn even! All right, I'll dance.
Horace, I never thought I'd hear you say a thing like that.
Upstairs, in you go!
Horace Vandergelder, what is going on up there?
Oh, nothing. I just thought I'd have that front room redone in blue wallpaper.
Horace?
I know, the old one's not worn out yet, but that fella's just set up in business and needs a good start. You see, Dolly, I've always felt that money, pardon the expression, is like manure. It's not worth a thing unless...
Thank you, Ephraim.
It's so nice to have you back where you belong. I never knew Dolly without you. Dolly, life was awfully flat, and more than that was awfully wrong.
Wonderful woman.